What's up, everybody? And we are back with the game you've all been waiting so patiently for. This is game three of DK versus Navi. Luminous is alongside with me once again. And are you super excited?
I am very super excited, but before we start, I want to give a formal apology. B-Balling wanted to bring you guys this game ASAP, but it was me losing power, being lazy. Well, not being lazy. I had to write my paper. But it's mostly me actually dragging the game behind. So, formal apology to all B-Balling fans.
It's okay. I think we're used to it. Basically, as you come to know me, I am always right, and everybody else is always wrong.
That's absolutely correct.
Okay.
If anyone tell you otherwise, it's either Nebula, or they're just wrong.
All right. Ready to start the game? Ready?
Yeah.
All right. 3, 2, 1, unpause. So this is game 3, WDC quarterfinals, and of course, by the time we're doing this, SMM has actually finished. So we'll try to bring you a lot of games from that tournament as well, but tuck yourselves back maybe 3.5 weeks ago to WDC quarterfinals, DK versus Navi, game 3, 1-1. Navi just pulled out an impressive victory with a pudge pick, and to be honest, for a lot of the initial portion of the game, DK looked like they were on the back foot, but I think they started to recover at the end nicely.
Yep, they had a really tough time dealing with that pudge. I think I was calling them, like, they were getting picked off one by one by one, and that's not something you see in a world-class Chinese team. That's something that you see in an average day pub. But towards the end, it seems like they're starting to figure out how to play against the pudge. So I think that was Navi's kind of one-trick thing. Like, you know, that they surprised DK, they got a win from it. Let's see if they're going to do it again, and if they do it again, let's see if DK can respond correctly.
Right, and we see some smart bans. Lycanthrope is just... I feel like Lycanthrope is probably the strongest carry in this metagame. He just seems to always win. Batrider and Boker, two very strong Chinese heroes. Nice bans by Puppy so far, as we see Chen, Broodmother, and Xiaodian being banned. So that leaves AA in the pool, that leaves Lich, that leaves, you know, Enchantress, that leaves Pudge. A lot of
that
strong heroes.
Seems like DK comfortable to not ban the pudge, and I do agree this is a correct decision. You don't want to waste one of the top tier bans. I mean, I think DK rather deals with Dendi's pudge, which again, I feel like they are really learning how to deal with it, than a, let's say, a Shadow Demon or a, you know, Art Style Chen, or Puppy Chen, excuse me, because Art Style's not here. Wyrmwind's going to be the first pick here, and then we have Syllabeer right as a response from DK.
And Syllabeer is just a beast in the Chinese metagame. He lanes better than most carries, or basically
I think he lanes better than any carry, aside from Destroyer, maybe.
Yeah, and he gets really farmed really fast. Of course, in the later parts of the game, his bear doesn't become too effective, but hey, that's why you have your hero. Just switch all your items there. Easy win. Well, not really easy win, but if you get enough farm early on, then you can get a lot of towers and really build on that advantage, snowball it up, and get to that prize of the Frozen Throne. Except they're killing the world tree.
Except they're killing on the world tree. Now, one of the coolest thing about Syllabeer is that he's only one of the few carries that could actually handle a lane by himself, even against dual tri lanes. Imagine an anti-mage trying to do that. Imagine a Weaver trying to do that. Weaver might be able to do it, but he won't get any farm. And Syllabeer will be able to most likely survive and find some farm as well. Now, traditionally, we don't see Syllabeer as the solo carry, so it's very likely that DK is going to pick another semi-carry that might be a little bit more effective in terms of ganking role and try to carry the weight a little bit. And yeah, we are going to see that pudge once again, and Navi picks it really early, maybe fearing a ban coming from the second stage.
Maybe they also want to see how DK reacts to it, but it looks like DK picks up a very powerful pusher with Ancient Apparition. It'll be interesting to see how they lane it. Probably solo mid, as is common these days with Ancient Apparition, but it looks like Navi is deciding, hey, we did all right, we beat probably the best team in the world at this moment.
They did,
coming
yes.
Coming into the tournament in the last game with Pudge and Enchantress, and Puppy's Enchantress did a lot of damage, even though I don't know if he was as aggressive as maybe an Art Style Enchantress, but still, they won, they did very well, so looks like they're going to go with what works, and they decide to ban the Puck, a really smart ban by Navi.
I'm surprised that Puck wasn't picked up any earlier for DK, because again, one of the probably the best hero in this pool, definitely going to be making some changes to your hero list that should be coming very, very soon. And we do see this Shaker and Ancient Apparition combination. We've seen it time and time after again. Shaker, if he roams into AX lane, most likely you get a for sure kill. You're combining at least 4 seconds of stun time if you do it properly. And also for team fight, we drop off a fissure. If you stun tier 3, Ancient Aberration Ice Blast is going to come in. It really have strong ganking potential. It has strong mid-game teamfight potential. And DK right now is building themselves a very strong mid-game lineup. Solo Bear really reaches peak once he picks up his Radiance around 25 minutes in. And you go for a big push. Not too sure whether Na'Vi could weather that storm. It's going to look to their Pudge, look to their Enchantress for some early game pressure and try to slow down.
Hey, Luminous, I'm going to let you finish.
All right.
I'm going to say this Ancient Apparition pick is one of the best of all time. Of all time. No, not really. But it's a really strong pick because Windrunner picks up that mecha, and it really shuts down a lot of Pudge's regen that he loves to get with Urn, with Hood, with Vanguard, with stuff like that. And it shuts down Enchantress's heal, so I think that really throws a monkey wrench in terms of what Na'Vi's going to do to push and win early on, because they already know that Silverbear is probably one of the strongest late-game carries, so either they have the choice to outlate the Silverbear, which is difficult, or they have to push really fast, which is difficult if Ancient Apparition gets a really fast level. So this is why I sort of think they picked up Ancient Apparition before the puck. I don't know. I might be completely wrong, but
no,
like you, I'm always right.
You are always right, and indeed you are right in this case as well. I completely agree with that, and I definitely did not see that, so thank you for pointing out. What Na'Vi, I feel like they're lacking is damage, and they do going to pick a Lich to kind of help for that, because imagine Lich wasn't there. Sure, the Enchantress is going to do some pure damage with her Impetus. Windrunner is not going to give you too much damage, and Pudge will give you some okay damage up to the mid-game, but he's going to put himself in a very dangerous position as well, especially you're up against a Silvery that who could tank so much. So they do pick up the Lich. The Chain Frost will be very helpful, considering that they do have stuns and slows that kind of sets people near each other. Shackle Shot grabs too. Enchant and Pudge Rot will just slow down a good deal of the Scourge team, who really isn't too mobile for the most part. So this Chain Frost from the Lich is a very decent pick. It gives them strong laning as well. It's going to give them one jungler with the Enchantress. Of course, Windrunner and Pudge are your decent solos, and we're most likely going to look for a last carry pick. Again, and lanes perfectly with that Lich. So Na'Vi bring themselves a pretty decent team. And Weaver going to be the counterpick for DK. What do you feel about that one?
Well, Weaver is always a decent pick in any stage of the game because he's versatile in terms of laning. He's versatile in terms of the items he picks up. And it's nice to see that Weaver won't go Radiant because Silverbear obviously will. So we're going to see a more aggressive Weaver, which is pretty nice to see because Weaver is one of those carries who is extremely versatile. And he can actually play quite well in the early stages of the mid-game with the Swarm, with the max level Shikuchi, just surviving all the team fights and being a beast before too many, you know, Hexes or Orchids are picked up or stuff like that. But I'm a little bit worried for Na'Vi because I don't think they have that much AoE right now. So if once the Silverbear picks up Radiance, I don't really see what Na'Vi can stop him with because they don't have much AoE. And looks like the range is on the Scourge side of the table with the Ice Blast, with the Fissure. Of course, Hook. Yeah. Hook and Hook is the only range that Na'Vi really has, so
I think they're going to live and die by the gank. If they allow the Silverbear to reach that Radiance maybe 25 minutes in, they are just dead. At least if the first four heroes going to be... they're not going to do enough damage to the Silverbear, and they're not going to be clearing the creeps quickly enough. And even you have, you know, Windrunner with Nuke, and even if you pick yet another Nuker, I don't think that's enough in between, because I'm sure Scourge will be pushing with the Mecha. You Nuke twice, it heals up, entire creep wave is bonus armored, and they're going to just rally your tower. Again, they don't do enough damage to kill the Spirit Bearer really efficiently and quickly. And unless Na'Vi surprises with a awesome pick here, I think they're going to have a little bit of trouble.
I think Ursa might be a smart pick here because he's the best. But instead we see a very standard anti-mage pick, which is smart and good.
I don't think that's
I don't
smart.
Know if it works well in this case. It's just sort of standard. Maybe a lack of any other options.
Well, I think as carry goes, there are definitely better AoE carries than an anti-mage. Anti-mage is like the epitome of a single right-click carry. And that doesn't solve the issue that you elegantly brought up. Where's the AoE coming in? How do you stop this push from DK? And DK with the last Crystal Maiden pick, last pick on the Crystal Maiden, that's just saying we're going to just push you. We're going to end this game in 25, 30 minutes. And whether you like it or not, you're not going to have enough AoE to deal with us. You don't have enough damage to deal with us. And DK right off the table, I feel like just from the pick stage, I think they're in a great advantage compared to Na'Vi's picks.
Well, you know what they say about Asian crystal maidens.
What I say about Asian crystal maidens?
Yo, they move mad fast because, you know, they get taken to a young age before the Olympics, and they're not allowed to develop being Asian, so
Yo, man,
they're gonna
they ain't
be way
16.
fast.
They legal age?
12 years old, legal age in
Man,
China.
no, man, they 18. Look at their birth certificates.
As we see, Silbert, nothing really too spectacular. And who has the words? Crystal Maiden has those early sentry words. Not really too sure what's happening right now. Just a lot of scouting and a lot of positioning. But looks like Dendi is going to be playing that Pudge solo mid. Puppy playing that Shen. Light of Heaven playing Winrar, soloing top. And a dual lane of M5G playing Lich. I think Lich is. M5G has been playing Lich every single game. And I'm actually
Yes.
surprised to see that the Chinese are like, okay, have Lich. Have Lich every game.
Well, actually, Lich, I mean, gives him that strong laning, but as mid game comes, he doesn't, as support goes, he doesn't have an AoE compared to Crystal Maiden, compared to Venge. At least Venge has a terror that, you know, actually pretty good at top in terms of weakening the wave. But, you know, aside from that, I want to point out two item choices for the Crystal Maiden. You can see that she's getting the Sentry Ward. That's going to basically says, I'm pulling, whether you like it or not. She pops one down, didn't find anyone there, any Sentry Ward there. And she's starting to get Paralord, but basically she's going to get the pull spot off. So that's going to really help out on the top lane. And also on the bottom lane here, Anti-Mage, now he has one top. Anti-Mage has picked up a Ring of Protection. Generally, you see a Stout Shield. That's an indication that he wants to go Vlads sometimes in this game. And Vlads generally is an indication that you want to go a really late game farm and you go Battle Fury Vlads, but not too sure whether he will have the time to do it. We'll have to wait and see.
Alright, time to pick your brain here for a little bit. Oh, Sensei Luminous, why do you think they switched the Windrunner to the bot lane and have the Lich Anti-Mage without warding the camp at all on the top spot? I'm not really too sure about this move. Don't you really want to get that Enchantress to get fast pushes on that lane?
I have no idea as well because, I mean, this is what we see a lot of Chinese team do. They really love to put the Lich on top lane and then start denying and make sure the Anti-Mage gets enough level and gets enough farm. And that's what's gonna happen. We're gonna have Anti-Mage get the farm. However, you're not stopping the Silbert from farming with a single Lich and Anti-Mage lane, and you're definitely not stopping the Crystal Maiden from farming. And Crystal Maiden with a double stack pull on the top lane. It's gonna deny an entire creep wave, and basically all that laning advantage you got from Lich is suddenly gone with that pull. So I feel like Scourge has a better laning as well. Mid lane, we see a Weaver going against a Pudge, and that's a very smart laning that just guarantees that you're not getting a kill on our mid lane. Good luck with that. So either Dendi's gonna be forced to do a lot of ganking, or that's the only thing he could do right now because he's not gonna kill the Weaver, he's not gonna outfarm the Weaver. So he either has to gank or he's gonna lose the lane all completely.
Well, Dendi is fortunate enough to pick up that top rune, even though Urshifu is staying there forever alone for a good 30 seconds on that bot rune spot. So with that illusion rune, he'll be able to, you know, do stuff. Pro analysis, get at it. Anyway, meanwhile, we have the Ancient Apparition soloing the bot lane. And that is a little bit of a surprise because you can't really kill the Weaver, like you said, with the Pudge, as we see a nice fissure and the Cold Feet being chained on the Windrunner nicely, but looks like Windrunner is going to be able to escape. And as I was going to say, Ancient Apparition these days, you usually like to go solo mid because you really want to get that fast level 6 and then send that Ice Blast where it doesn't travel as long a distance. So I'm a little bit puzzled by putting Weaver. I guess, you know, really just don't want to be killed, but I think Ancient Apparition could have handled himself fine, but they fear that Pudge.
Yeah, I definitely agree. Ancient Aberration generally plays in the mid lane because once he hits level 6, the Ancient Aberration Ice Blast, I mean, it basically cuts your distance to travel by half. I hope we caught that
I
as we
did
saw.
catch it. It was a
Okay.
frostbite and then a lot
A
of
couple
right
of right
clicks.
clicks. Yep. Yeah, so generally you put the Ancient Aberration back in the mid lane so his Ancient Aberration Ice Blast gets ganks off a lot easier. You could, you know, have a lot easier time to aim it. But I think really they don't want this Pudge to get ahead because the only way they're gonna lose is when Dendi gets so fat on that Pudge where he could roam the enemy jungle and just basically drive fear up in DK. And that's exactly what happened in game two. So there, you know what? If we just mitigate that mid lane as much as we can, and you know, even so we're gonna put a weaker AA on the bot, that's fine. As long as Dendi don't get big, we could win the game. So they're gonna concede the ward a little bit, or battle, whatever, but they're gonna win the war. That's kinda
Sorry to
what I feel
burst your
like
bubble a
indicating.
bit, Luminous, but Pudge is already fat. He is a fat mother effer.
He's just big.
Some people might say he's big boned.
Big boned there right now, but he's gonna get fat if he gets a lot of kills.
And Weaver actually picking up the bottle and beat that Pudge. The rune beating that Pudge is slow as heck, and Weaver has max move speed. He picks up an illusion rune, so nice job rune controlling by Super. And it's gonna be interesting to see Super play that Weaver. Usually he plays more typical solo mid heroes, but I guess this might indicate that we might be able to see a bit more of an aggressive Weaver, considering we have Burning on that Silbear and, you know, all of that stuff. As I see Long DD pulling already level 3 with that Crystal Man. Meanwhile, just check out Puppy's farm. He is level 4 with that Enchantress, so at least they're getting a fast level on Enchantress, but keep in mind that Anti-Mage is not being allowed to free farm quite so effectively, as it looks like there's a tiny bit of action. Anti-Mage actually migrated to the bottom lane and moving Lich to solo top. Very interesting.
Yep, and looks like Windrun in a little bit of trouble. Level 5 here. Windrun, I think, already has been expanded. Looks like, wow, the Shaker is going to get caught here. Looks like he's going to change direction, but he's ultimately going to go down. Havolt's going to pick up the kill. Now they're going to go for Ancient Apparition. Let's see how good the micro is. Stomp number 1 threatening. No, there's a dodge on the stomp number 1, but stomp number 2 is going to get him. Looks like Ancient Apparition is going to go down. Havolt's last hits 2 kills there. And that's going to give him the farming advantage as he sorely lacked on top.
Meanwhile, Denny's in a lot of trouble on the mid lane. Swarm went on him, and Weaver, Pudge to emo. Tired of life, tired of being put down by the mainstream, decides to end it all.
Must went to school in Cornell, or that or Japanese.
Yeah, or Japanese.
If you didn't get chat reference, Japan has the highest suicide rate of all country. Burning. Gets off a lagging kill, and I don't know how he got there, but he does have a face boots, and he chased probably the Lich for an hour with that face boot, but got the kill, so good job.
Yeah, I'll be honest, I was not looking at that kill, even though I caught every other one so far, but a Lich getting killed by a solo Silver? I mean, I'm not really expecting that at any point in the game, but it looks like DK is handling themselves quite well, except for that bot lane, but it's a little bit nullified, considering Winner switched back to whatever the heck she's doing right now, and Anti-Mage is going to farm that safer bot lane and not going to be hampered by pulls, but I think it would have been better if now we just put that Anti-Mage on the bot lane from the start, to be quite honest.
Yep, I agree with you, because I feel like right now Na'Vi feels like they're completely getting outlaned. They're switching their lanes around, and you know, it's gonna benefit the Scourge, as they don't have to waste time going from lane to lane. I want to point out the exchange of EXP for the Enchantress in the jungle. She's level 5 with a successful dual gank on the bot lane. So level 4 Crystal Maiden, who is doing nothing but pulls. Now you would expect Enchantress to get ahead because she is a jungling hero, of course, and also she got the 2 kills on the bot lane. But Crystal Maiden just doing nothing but pulls and providing very little assistance in lane is allowed to get to level 4.5, and she's quite level dependent support. So I'm glad to see that she's getting a lot of level, and I feel like Scourge is still getting the better exchanges in most of these engagements, whether it's going to be levels, whether it's going to be farm. I feel like DK's ahead.
I feel kind of bad for Dendi, because this is really an impossible lane for him to win, because Weaver can just outspeed him to any rune. He can push lane with the Swarm, and Dendi's just throwing out a mad amount of hooks, just hoping desperately that Super will be caught by one, but Super's positioning has been not phased by this Pudge so far, and Dendi is just forced to stay back, so this Pudge is really having a difficult time, and that's the risk you take when you pick a Pudge. You're going to have a trouble laning him, and if you don't get enough items, you're not going to be very useful in that mid-game.
Yep, I'm really surprised that the Pudge haven't left the lane altogether and went for ganks, because kind of like I said, you're not going to win the lane by farming, you're definitely not going to win the lane by killing. I think they should have put the Windrunner, or maybe even the Lich a little bit on the mid lane, and just put someone in the mid lane and allow that Pudge to start ganking and roaming, because if he doesn't get anything going like that, he's not going to be useful at all this whole game.
Right, and we see Vos 21-7, not very good farm considering Vos has been farming quite well, as we see a gank on the top lane, Freezebite by the Crystal Maiden, or Frostbite, god. And Burning picks up another kill on a killing spree, and Burning is just playing sensationally, or as you'd say, beautifully, as he is a very beautiful bear.
Yo, Burning's on fire otherwise. Right now, no pun intended, he's got almost 40 creep kills in 8 minutes, a decent 5 a minute, got 3 kills, and now threatening the top tower. Crystal Maiden, level 5.5 with boost speed picked up, and here we go. Say bye-bye to your level 1 tower on top lane, because you have no AoE to defend this. Mew on the mid lane here. Swarm goes on the Pudge. Pudge at half HP. Weaver goes on the offensive, really dodging that bite for now, and looks like he's going to kite this Pudge all day long. Pudge regening up. The hook is going to miss, and that's going to be end. As we see, Puppy got a kill on the bot lane. And will Sentinel transition this off to a push? I don't think they are.
No, it looks like they just want to get Anti-Mage as farmed as possible, but like you said, you have to try to end the game fast with the Silverware, but you can't really do that with the Anti-Mage on your side, or the Lich, who is really adept at denying. And Lich going to the bot lane! This is just some crazy Na'Vi switching all around, as Winter is back to the top lane where she truly belonged, but it might be a little bit too little too late, or not too little, but a little bit too late in terms of laning phase, as Silverware already doing very well. And overall, you might be saying, oh, Na'Vi's owning bot lane. Well, DK doesn't care because they're literally owning mid lane and top lane. I mean, Super has been playing sensationally, Burning just doing his thing, so just... I think DK will take that, especially since Anti-Mage had to switch lanes and has not enough farm compared to Silver at all.
Yep, and even though the Scourge team is losing the bot lane, I don't think it's to a degree that it makes up for that deficit that you were talking about on the other lanes. Shaker's level 3.5, which isn't bad for a Shaker that's been, you know, pretty much roaming to the rune every time it spawns. Ancient Aberration is level 6, so he could assist in the ganks right now. Pudge waiting for that hook. Let's see if he's gonna get it right now. Oh, there's a hook! It's gonna find someone. It's gonna be Shaker. Immediate bite, not gonna allow time for that fissure. And this is what Dendi needs to continuously do and start to get themselves back in the game. But back to my point, the bot tower is still up. So despite losing a couple of kills there, DK not in a terrible position. Meanwhile, Silverware still free farming on the top lane, got himself a tower kill as well. And he is up to how much gold? 3,000 gold, 10 minutes in.
And Crystal Main came around with the Invisor and drops a bite on the Windrunner. And will Burning get another kill dominating? Which is what Burning tends to do in these games. And I was about to say, Na'Vi doesn't look so bad because Earthshaker is only level 3. But meanwhile, there's more action going on in the mid lane. Looks like ROTK does take the fall. And a nice hook by Dendi. Unfortunately,
wow.
Weaver is the biggest buzzkill in all of Dota.
He definitely is. Haste Rune plus Sakuchi and Time Lapse. Not gonna lie with that unfairness. It looks like Crystal Maiden might be a little bit trouble in the mid lane. Good vision. They're gonna block off the Lich. And that's gonna be the end of that exchange. Nicely done. I feel like Yoru, and this is exactly what you're talking about. He's gonna play aggressive. And this is like the fourth or fifth time he's diving past tower like no one's business. He's gonna find himself Lich. Medallion gonna pop on the Lich, and you can see between his physical right hits and the germinating attack, he's doing just so much right click damage. And it looks like mid tower threatening to be taken off as well.
I feel like I was gonna have like a point to say, but then the Chinese just interrupt me, and being obnoxious as all the Chinese people usually are. Anyway, I was gonna say, if there's one flaw for DK, it's that Ancient Apparition is not farming well, and that Earthshaker is still level 3, but that won't matter when Burning is just picking up dominating kills, has 3,000 gold, 10 minutes in the game, 12 minutes in the game, what does he have now? Oh look, he has 3,600.
He's gonna have a 15-minute radiance, and there's really nothing DK could do, nothing Na'Vi could do about it. By the way, Anti-Mage going for the same build that he did in game number 1, which is Vanguard into Vlad, as we see Pudge biting the Weaver, gonna finally get the kill, nicely hooking into a Sentry Ward, and they need a lot more of that. So Dendi keeping themselves in the game, but the score, they are only up by one kill, they're down by one tower, and looks like they're trying to get a little bit of push going on in mid lane.
Yeah, that might be the right choice to do, considering Earthshaker and Ancient Apparition are both on the bot lane, and Crystal Maiden migrated there as well, so now is the time for Na'Vi to go for it. Looks like they're gonna do just that, but keep in mind, Burning is just eating through that creep wave, and once he gets his radiance, he literally will be burning, as
yes.
Those radiances do hurt. Radiance burn damage. Just go with that.
Sparkly stuff. All right, what do you feel about Vlad's Vanguard on the Anti-Mage? He went for the exact same build in game number 2 when he was playing the Anti-Mage there. I mean, it definitely had a place in that game because they were trying to be a little bit more offensive in terms of pushing. Now, in terms of this game, when you're counter pushing, do you think this is the best item build, or do you think there's a better item build that you could go for?
I think the best item build would be not to get ganked, which he successfully avoids doing. But in terms of the overall game, I don't think Vlad's nor Vanguard will help you too much against the Silverbear, who's going to be the real problem in these team fights. I mean, Vlad's, you can't regen under the Ancient Apparition Ice Blast regardless, but I'm not really sure what other items he could go for. Maybe Manta to Does Manta dispel the Ice Blast buff or debuff?
I think so. I think so.
They should do a DWS on it. Oh, anyway. When not knowing how
I'm pretty sure
works,
it does.
Just
I'm going to say it does.
Do DWS on it. But I think Vanguard is a fine choice. I'm not too sure about Vlad's. That's my end point.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like this is almost a wrong hero. It doesn't matter really what item he gets. It's the wrong item because this hero is not really capable of dealing with the Scourge lineup. Scourge gonna mold down the mid tower for free. Burning picks that one up, and his current gold, well, he's about 100 away from a Radiance.
This is.
Oh man.
I remember watching Light of Heaven one game. Like literally, they left him by himself, and he managed to farm 13-minute Radiance. But keep in mind, they literally did not go into his lane, and there were people on top for a bit.
He got 4 kills, so someone
yeah.
was in his lane, so, and, you know, now they're just pushing in, and Na'Vi is being humiliated right now, it feels like, because, well, the score is 6-5, but they're losing so badly.
It's okay, those troll nets ensnaring that Ancient Apparition, but Ancient Apparition just says, lol, you're not powerful in this game, it ain't Warcraft 3.
Yo, man, Warcraft 3 troll nets.
Ensnare. As we see... Like I was saying earlier, Earthshaker is actually underleveled, but I forgot at that point to take a look at poor God. Poor M5G for NS. For his buddy really? NS, this is how he's being treated by Na'Vi, just not even close to level 6. And this lineup is not really going too well for Na'Vi overall, but there's still a way. When you're with Na'Vi, you always try to find a way, and right now if... They can keep ganking the supports. Anti-Mage is actually in a lot of trouble. Gets a chain stun nicely. Ice Blast is being thrown down. Did Ice Blast actually miss?
Yeah, Ice Blast did actually miss, and so did the Cold Feet, because ROTK says, can't click today. Cold Feet wasn't dropped on the Anti-Mage, and if it was, probably would have got the kill. Looks like we're going to see a big gank coming in from the Scourge. The team is smoked up. Lich, critically not level 6 yet, and that's going to make them pay, I feel like. Dendi looking for a hook. Who they're gonna initiate? I'm gonna go on the Crystal Maiden or the Ancient Apparition. Here we go, the right clicks from Isilibur. Gonna bring the Anti-Mage at half HP. He's gonna go down before anyone else does. Ancient Apparition goes down immediately as well. Pudge being surrounded by 3 or 4. He's gonna be the next one to follow. Drops up by before he does die off. But Scourge standing the ground. A Sentinel trying to get this gank. I'm not too sure why Sentinel just went really ballsy with that. As we see, the Lich gonna go down as well. Did drop the Chain Frost, but. Lucky bounces.
A nice shackle shot by Light of Heaven. Mage just to save Puppy. Light of Heaven's doing all he can, and looks like Windrunner and Chat just about to escape with their lives. So keep in mind, during that whole fight, Burning for some reason didn't even have his Radiance, even though he had the gold for it and he had the recipe. He was like, you know, I feel like I should give Na'Vi a chance, make them feel a little bit better about themselves. But then he's like, nah, bro, I'm just going to take it, pick it up as Anti-Mage is going to jump on that Earthshaker. Anti-Mage got really. A bit unlucky as he was continuously gripped. He got frostbitten and entangled in that last fight. A nice shackle shot again by Light of Heaven. Manages to catch the Earthshaker. Earthshaker dies as well, but looks like Burning doesn't care. 2700 HP, Bear with the Radiance doesn't care either, and Anti-Mage is forced to retreat.
Yep, and Anti-Mage really, I mean, that was a pretty good fight for Na'Vi. Good move by DK choosing to run there. I think a lot of times says, oh, a single person TPing in? Let me just all right click them. Good decision by DK to run there because they would have lost so much more if they didn't. But also I want to point out there, you saw how quickly Anti-Mage's HP dropped from Crystal Maiden nuke, and that's a benefit of having a highly leveled Crystal Maiden because her nukes at this point hurt. She's out-leveling the Lich, she's out-leveling the Enchantress. Oh, well, not really, but you know, her nukes will hurt them because you don't expect a Max Nova at this stage of the game. Fissure is going to be dropped on 2-hero. Punch Hook is going to hit once again on the Shaker. Going to get themselves a kill. Looks like they're going to give chase on the Ancient Apparition. Na'Vi on the verge of making a comeback. They're going to be up by 3 kills here. And they're going to try to push this spot tower. Really, really good sign of a comeback as they're giving themselves a little bit more time before that impending push from Isilibur is going to be coming.
Right, because Silverbear, like you always say, once he picks up the reins, he should get at least 2 towers. Just rushing down the middle, like a running back through the NFL defense. Let's see how Super is doing in terms of items. He has picked up a Robe of the Magi.
Not really too sure, Django. Yep.
But he doesn't really need move speed. Not really too sure. I guess, you know, because Django is
a good item. Team item.
He might have what?
The team item.
Oh, it's a team item. But Weaver is not a team hero. Weaver doesn't care. As ROTK manages to pick up a kill, I missed that, and looks like Antimage perishes as well because of Ice Blast and because of the Frostbite and Cold Feet and Ice Blast just own Antimage. So a little of the advantage that Na'Vi had just got quickly halted, and now it looks like the momentum is back in DK's favor. It's their turn to serve, and looks like Dendi is playing well. Navi's overall playing okay. It's
they
just
are.
That they put themselves in too big of a disadvantage with their lanes and with their picks. So they're going to have to completely outplay DK, which I don't know is possible at this stage, but hey, anything's possible in Dota.
Yep. 2D want to point out, number one, Crystal Maiden skill build, Max Nova, Max Bite, Aura level 2. I mean, this is the offensive type of Crystal Maiden you get to do if you're having such an early hero lead. 20 minutes in, we see a level 10 Crystal Maiden. I know I'm really stuck on the Crystal Maiden because she's one of my favorite heroes of all time, but game after game, we're seeing very versatile Crystal Maiden builds, and we saw another one in this game. Second thing I want to point out is that the reason that Pudge wasn't as dominating as he was in game number 2 is, if you notice DK's movement, they are always traveling as a pack. And against the Pudge, that's what you always need to do, but despite that, Dendi still got some great hooks, and that's a true testament of how good he is. But if you stay together, you're going to, you know, limit that as much as you can.
It looks like Silver actually picked up a Hyperstone for his bear, and they have the Aegis. This is what I like about DK compared to other Chinese teams. They're like, all right, let's win, and then they push. And they at least get one tower when they do that. And then, you know, the Chinese just kicks in effect. They're like, okay, we got a tower. Let's just farm for a bit. So, but at least they push.
No, man, they're defending top. Don't even trip.
Defending top, right?
Yeah.
It was under such grave threat, you know, being at full HP.
Yo, man, you don't want to give the enemy team a full 1,000 gold, because you never know what they're trying to do with that 1,000 gold. Puppy, by the way, trying to finish that Axe Scepter. He's about halfway there. Pudge does have the urn here. And let me check out how Anti-Mage is doing on the gold. He does have 300 gold in the bank. Looks like he's going to go right on the top lane for Ancient Aberration. ROTK, half HP. Eats a ultimate from the Anti-Mage as well. He's going to be absolutely fine. Anti-Mage taking a lot of tower focus, but looks like he is going to be making their life. I do like what Hovos is doing. Despite that, they're not, well, they're winning in terms of hero kills, but I feel like the game is kind of disadvantaged against them. But you notice how Hovos is playing so aggressive. Sometimes his own demise, like on the bot lane, but really he's looking for the kills whenever he can get it.
Nice play by Dendi, managing to hook Winrar, or else he surely would have died with Super on his ass and with the Ice Blast taking effect. But a hook from Dendi managed to save his ally. And Dendi and Light of Heaven are really trying to keep Na'Vi in the game, but it's going to come down to Avost and Puppy in terms of dealing out damage. So it looks like the Scourge are going to smoke up. They have a level 7 Earthshake with Arcane Boots and Puppy. You are in
Puppy.
A world of hurt.
Oh, the nukes from CM, it hurts!
Wasn't CM, Weaver!
No,
God, your fanboyism for CM.
Level 11 CM, picking up mass.
Wait,
mass
Lumi, are you cheating on me with CM? Is that what this is about?
No, man, it's not cheating if it's... There's no feelings involved with CM, not like with b-balling.
As we see, Silver extremely close to that AC, about 700 gold away, about like 200 gold after that tower. 100, sorry. And Django's fish on the Weaver, Mecha fish on the AA. Na'Vi are forced to stick in their base for a bit as the score is 11-11. Their lone bright spot is that Light of Heaven is landing a lot of shackle shots.
Yep. Well, G has a Breach of Seed and level 7 now.
He's got the magic stick. I was about to say Wand of Illusion, but never
He's
mind.
Even got 3 charges on that Wand of Illusion. You know? So
bad illusions, yo.
Not looking good at all here. Vlad is completed for the Anti-Mage. And I'm really baffled here. And it goes back to what I said earlier. I don't think there's any item combination that he have gotten that would have made any difference with the, you know, same price of gold that you would spend on Vanguard and Vlad. I just think that's an incorrect hero choice here.
Right. Maybe he's like, okay, I'll pull a Fury in, or I'll pull a Spectre and just try to farm and push other lanes at the same time. But they can't do that when Silver is literally knocking at the door with his giant paws. A hook goes in, try to catch the Weaver. But look at Silver continuing to knock at the door saying, let me into your base, guys. And Na'Vi's like, no! Go away, Jesuit priest, or something like that. As a giant teamfight is breaking out, Crystal Maine at half HP, a lot of action going on. Let's see if Enchantress is going to get entangled. Nope, that Silverberry cannot catch up to her, and Dendi is still on the prowl for those hooks, but nothing is happening, and that tier 3 tower did die at the same time. The bear gets hooked and gets owned. But hey, new bear. Dendi dies in one swipe. Chainfrost being dropped off. Let's see if they can kill the Silverberry. Keep in mind, he has an Aegis, and that bear will still be alive with that Aegis, but he will not be in true form. So if not, he can take advantage of that. But looks like DK recognized that fact. They just crowd around him, and they're going to prevent the death of that Silverberry again. Looks like DK is just tanking it up right now.
Man, Light of Heaven is landing some beautiful Shaco shot, but it's just ultimately not enough with the Aegis. Having that advantage, Burning says, right-click Rax. We're going to see a 24-minute Rax by DK, and well, safe to say that Navi will be going home now.
Right, I mean, honestly, there's not much hope, considering Antimage's item build, which is Vanguard into Vlad's, and Silver has AC Radiance in 24 minutes. Check out his gold really fast. 2100 in the bank, and that's what you do when you get Silver. But to be fair, Navi's cool. That's what
Navi's cool. Navi's only pro team today plays Dota 1 with Pudge.
Right. And Dota 2 with Pudge, apparently.
Well, Dota 2, actually, a lot of teams are using Pudge now, so.
Oh, really?
Actually, pretty cool.
I can't really play that game. I don't know if you've heard.
Yeah, I heard.
I have this computer.
I'm telling you, every time you say that, we're going to start a fun PC donation for D-balling.
Lol. As you see, Silver's continuing to roam the map. Crystal Maiden, you know, being a bitch, per usual.
Crystal Maiden, level 11, 4-staff, phase wood. Dang, this is a luminous build here.
This is a crap build. Crap build by a crap hero.
That's exactly what is winning the game for Navi. Not even that Celebrity. Celebrity is just like, you know.
I think Celebrity begs to differ for some odd reason.
Number two role, you know? Number three is the Weaver. But it's
no,
really
number two
game.
Is Weaver, and then number three is AA, and then number four is that grass on the Scourge side of the pet field, like that little patch of grass right here. And then number five is Roshan being on the Scourge side, and then number six is the...
I'm feeling a lack
Shaker,
of support.
And then number seven is like the Vulture, even though it's...
How do you put a patch of grass on Sentinel side higher than a Shaker?
Well, Shaker didn't do anything in this game.
Yo, man, got some sick figures. Don't even trip.
Anyway, CM, not good.
It skills Frost Armor just right now, man. They would have loved Frost Armor early. I think if you're ever in a situation like this, you know, doesn't matter what you really skill on Lich, but I think actually skipping your Nova at level 7 and getting Frost Armor would actually be better.
Maybe God was just so shell-shocked after being level 7 or level 5 like 20 minutes in the game. And Burning is going to go down the tower. Another Shackle Shot catches Burning. But they hook in the Earthshaker. Earthshaker just goes okay and drops the Echo Slam. Still alive with that Pipe of Insight going on. And looks like Crystal Maine drops an ultimate for the full duration. Doesn't do anything because it's Crystal Maine and Weaver and Burning managed to take home the rest of the gravy as Antimage buys back, trying to get something to happen, but then realizes, oh wait, I can't.
Nope. Can't even kill Crystal Maiden because she's the strongest unit.
Oh wait.
Never mind. That goes shot. Oh! Does go down as well, but let's see if Silliber gonna, you know, revenge the carry a little bit. Wow, Hovold's being so aggressive and it's gonna pay, but unfortunately he did fall down as well. It looks like Light of Heaven's gonna be next. Weaver giving chase. Swarm's gonna be there. Oh, she's gonna run safely back to Fawn. Looks like Silverbear says, okay, gonna take your Rax.
So yeah, Burning. Pretty good. Always
MVP.
Wins. So, I think it's pretty much safe to say at this point. Ah! Hold on, I will edit this part out as giant things popped up all over my screen.
Yo, man.
Ignore
don't
that
be, don't be looking at Prawn.
Anyway, what do you think Navi could have done differently besides pick better?
They could have picked better.
Okay.
I don't think they did it. Well, they could have lane better too. That's one thing they could have done.
Yeah, maybe if they stuck with their original lanes, put Winner up top.
But even so, even if they put Winner up top, Crystal Maiden was going to get the pull off regardless. Silliber is going to get farmed regardless. The mid lane for Sentinel was lost regardless. So I mean, even with the better laning, I don't think it would have mattered. It's just the heroes, and I feel like the Na'Vi got completely outpicked. And it's sad to see, it's so anticlimactic, you know?
Yeah, it's a little bit depressing after that epic game, too. But this is what happens when you play the best Dota team at this point in time, in the quarterfinals of WDC. You're gonna get owned. And not to like be a total spoiler sport, but you don't think the grand final is ever gonna be released?
No, I don't think they're ever gonna be released.
Okay. Well, DK is still good. Na'Vi looks like they might stick to Dota 2 after this, as Dota 2 is quickly becoming extremely popular. But let's see if they have it in them for one last push, maybe kill Burning once and for all, and then get owned by everybody else. As Burning picks up the Demon Edge, probably gonna go for Rapier just because he can. And looks like the GG push is gonna be incoming. Another hook misses. Dendi is really liberal with those hooks.
Man, that's how you play Pudge.
Look at these shackle shots, light of heaven.
It's just not enough, man. Oh man, Pudge, if he had that hook, meanwhile Puppy dies somewhere. Like, this is the most anticlimactic ending push. It's like...
it's basically Scourge pushes in, Na'Vi can't do anything.
Yep.
So, yeah. Overall, pretty good series, I have to say.
Pretty decent series. Game 2 was an extremely beautiful showcase Pudge how to play, but game number 3 showcased also how to beat Pudge at a high level.
And how to play Silverbear. Just get a lot of kills and get calculated entangles, as clearly that's what Burning does. As looks like CM is still alive, unfortunately.
And OP hero.
Yeah.
Can't handle.
As
I feel like DK is actually not ending this on purpose.
Really?
Like, he chased me to the fountain like 8 times. Like, okay, you wanna fight? Alright, let's extend this as long as we can. Look, they're fountain diving right now because, you know, getting mega creeps is not as important.
Well, yeah. You know.
Yeah, nothing to say, right? Because
yeah,
that's fucking
best Dota 2 team. Because we're the best Dota 1 team at this point. GG, well played call by Havost, as I think our endgame analysis was actually covered quite heavily during the past 10-15 minutes of this game.
Past 15 was the endgame analysis.
Yeah.
Oh, we see a 15-minute radiance. All right, let's go into endgame analysis.
So, looks like that's the end of this game. So, thank you for watching this very spectacular quarterfinals, and at this point, SMM replays are coming out, and we'll be casting quite a few of those. Those are not going to be casted every single one, because there are a lot more games, and it's actually finals and a lot of papers due for a lot of the staff members, so we can't cast every single game. So it'll be the usual first come, first serve in terms of claiming them. I know Luminous has been able to claim very good games. I tried to get a very nice game myself, and we'll see if Doc or Nebula or Coldblade manage to catch good games in themselves, and maybe Ian as well. So be on the lookout for those. Any last words, Lumi?
Nope. Hope you guys have a pretty good holiday. And don't worry, we will entertain your holiday with more games, as B-Balling promised as well. And I think it will just be... Speaking this for B-Balling myself, it's going to be our last Dota 1 stuff. I think both of us are going to be moving to Dota 2 as well. So don't get too sentimental, but
right.
It's going to happen.
Well, I'm going to stick with Dota 1 until I get a Dota 2 beta key. So,
Until Dota 2 comes out for Mac. Yeah.
Or I get a new PC.
Don't worry, I got beta keys for you. I got you hooked up.
Okay. Okay, man. As that's the end of this game, DK moves on to the semifinals, and unfortunately it doesn't look like the other games will be released. So if you haven't watched the results, then go learn them, because dang, this tournament's been over for like 3 weeks already. But DK ultimately wins this tournament, so well played by them. And good job to Na'Vi putting up a good fight in game 2, and that's it for me. So hope you guys all enjoyed it. Yeah, peace out, guys. Have a fantastic day.